प्रपन्न पारिजाताय तोत्र वेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः ओम डियर फ्रेंड्स वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ गीता वी आर सीइंग द 13th चैप्टर दैट इज क्षेत्र क्षेत्रज्ञ विभाग योग In that, we were reading shloka, we read shloka number 25 yesterday. Shloka number 25, 24 and 25, these two verses, they talked about different levels of seekers. So, the top level seeker, he is at the level of what is called nididhyasana. Then the middle level seeker, he is at the level of atma vichara. He is going to a teacher who is listening to Vedanta Shastra and then he is pursuing that viveka. Viveka means this panchakosha viveka, atmanatma viveka, shariratraya viveka, etc., etc. Then there is a third level man who is merely doing karma yoga. And there is much lower level, there is somebody who is not even aware of this karma yoga, very, very ordinary man. So this ordinary man, he just goes to a teacher, some kind teacher, he tells him some simple methods about, okay, you do this meditation, you do this pranayama, keep on doing this japa and you will, after some time you come to me. So after some time he goes, after some time he tells something, okay, you meditate on this. So like that also, some people, they cross over. Cross over what? They cross over this migration, this cycle called transmigration. So that is what we saw in shlokas 24 and 25. Now 26, Krishna is going to say one more important thing. That is, of course, we have seen this even earlier, because the nature of teaching is such that even if it is told earlier, it will be told again and again in newer and newer words. Because we have to be told in so many times, so we have to be told so many times, so that it gets imprinted on our mind. So he says in this shloka, it is whatever happens, whatever you see in the universe, it is all by this kshetra, kshetrajna, sanyoga. Whatever beings you see, all this, it is only by the combination of kshetra and kshetrajna. So he is saying that. Yavat, this is shloka number 26 I am reading. Yavat sanjayate kinchit sattvam sthavara jangamam kshetra kshetrajna sanyogat tadviddhi bharatarshabha. Hey bharatarshabha, that last word is sambodhana. In English, normally in English or Telugu we say, we do the sambodhana first. In Sanskrit, the sambodhana can be there. It can be in the beginning, it can be in the middle, it can be in the end. Because the structure of Sanskrit sentence is such that we know that it is a sort of inflectional language where the words, the case ending is built into the word. So it can be there anywhere. So, hey Bharatarshabha, oh bull among the Bharata clan, that means, oh, you are a mighty warrior. Then he is saying, oh Arjuna, yavat sanjayate kinchit. Yavat kinchit, that means yat kinchit, whatever. That yavat to be connected with this kinchit. Yavat kinchit sanjayate. Yavat kinchit means whatever. Whatever sanjayate. Sanjayate means is born. Jayate. Jayate for jayate. Sam is only an upasarga. Upasarga is a prefix. Sanjayate means whatever appears, whatever manifests, or whatever is born. Whatever is born in this universe, sattvam, sattvam is being. We are now talking about beings. Now we are not talking about inanimate things. Sattvam, sthavara jangamam, sthavara jangama. Sthavara means trees, those which do not move. Stha means to stay. Stha, the Sanskrit root stha means to stay. The same as, there are two cognate words again. Sthavara means all these trees, bushes, plants, etc., etc. Jangama is that which moves, keeps on gam dhatu, gam is to go. Sthavara jangamam, those which don't move and those which move, sthavara jangamam. Then kshetra kshetrajna sanyogat, whatever being comes into this existence, it is all because of the kshetra kshetrajna sanyoga. Kshetra is that whatever is called prakriti. Kshetrajna is the knower, the purusha. Kshetrajna is the knower. And Kshetra is the field. Kshetrajna is the field knower, that is sentient and insentient. The combination of sentient and insentient is responsible for the origin of all things. So that is a statement. So of course there are so many points, there is an important point in this we have to analyze. So, Kshetra Kshetrajna Sanyogat Tad Vidhi Bharatarshabha. Hey Bharatarshabha, Tad Vidhi, you know that. So, Krishna has made a categorical statement. Whatever you find in this universe, whatever being has come into this existence, whether it is Sthavara or Jangama, whether it is something which is of the nature of trees, plants, etc., or of the nature of animals or be human beings, whatever is having life, all these things, it is because of the combination of Kshetra and Kshetrajna. So, what is this Kshetra and Kshetrajna? Then you get a doubt. You see, he has made a statement, there is a because of the combination of Kshetra and Kshetrajna, all things come into existence. What type of combination is this? Because this is a Kshetra, I am seeing this pen, and I am the knower, let me say. I am the knower, then suppose I see this Kshetram, then what is the connection between me and this? I am holding this, this connection is, I am just holding it in my hand, which means that there is a samslesha, there is an attachment of limbs. I am having some limbs, and this thing also is having some limb, and I am holding it. So, because I am having a limb, and this is also having a limb, I am holding it. So, this, when I say I am referring to my body-mind complex. I am not referring to this, Chaitanya. This Chaitanya is something which is reflecting in myself. Chaitanya is something which is reflecting in my antahkarana, and which is enabling me to do this. When I say, I am holding this, my body is holding this, the Kshetrajna is, real Kshetrajna is not holding it. So, when I say, I am holding it, I am also Kshetram, this is also Kshetram. So, this combination can happen in a Kshetram, because an avayavi, avayavi means that which has got some limbs, can meet another avayavi. I can meet my hand is an avayava, avayava means a limb. This limb can get in touch with another limb. I can shake hands, I can hug somebody, I can put my arm around the waist of somebody. So, all these things, that is because there is another person who also has some limbs. I can touch that person and then I can hold that person, I can shake hands with that person. So, that is possible. But here, what type of sambandha is it? This sambandha in logic, they analyze this sambandha also. What is this? This sambandha is called samslesha, by holding one avayavi interacting with another avayava. Then suppose there is another type of sambandha. For example, take this cloth. In this cloth, what is this cloth made of? Cloth is made of threads only long threads. And those long threads, parallel and warp and what is that called, warp and weft or something like that, is it warp and weft, yeah, some such word, two words are there, that is one line grows like this and another the perpendicular thing. So, they are all brought together and then that weaver brings them together and then makes that cloth. In mills, of course, it happens in a much, much faster way. So, because by that, this cloth is made. So, the connection or sambandha between cloth and the thread. What is the sambandha? The sambandha between the cloth and the thread is that the thread is something which is inherent in that cloth. Thread is something which is an inherent part of that cloth. It is called inherence. The sambandha is called inherence. In Sanskrit, they call it samavaya. Samavaya sambandha. Without this thread, cloth is not there. Suppose you take out the thread, cloth is no longer there. So, that is samavaya sambandha. So, when you say the kshetra, kshetrajna, sanyoga, when you say sanyoga, what type of sanyoga is this? So, it has to be understood, it has to be explained. So, it's knower, the pure knower, kshetrajna, what is the nature of kshetrajna? So far as we have seen, kshetrajna is the same as that supreme reality. And that supreme reality which is Brahman is something which is niravayavi. It is of the nature of pure consciousness. It is something which is infinite in nature. And in that infinite thing, there is no avayava, there are no limbs. When there are no limbs, what type of contact are you expecting? So then, that is where the commentators come to our rescue. The commentators come to our rescue and say that this sanyoga is because of attribution of qualities of one over the other by ignorance. Because of our own ignorance, this whatever happens, this antakarana, that chit pratibimba is there. Chit pratibimba means chaitanya pratibimba. That chaitanyam which is reflecting in this consciousness, on this intellect, it is called chidabhasa. Chaitanya reflecting on the intellect is called chidabhasa. That is something which is a reflection of that consciousness. So then when that chidabhasa falls on the intellect, then this intellect gets activated. And the chidabhasa, that chaitanya, it appears as though it gets identified with the body-mind complex. So what happens is, the qualities of the body-mind complex are attributed to the chidabhasa. The qualities of the body-mind complex means, the body-mind complex again is different with respect to each individual. My body-mind complex is different, your body-mind complex is different. That is, the composition of sattva-guna, rajo-guna, tamo-guna, the composition of, in fact, these three gunas only are there in everybody, starting from an ant to a dinosaur. So, the sattva, rajas and tamas. So, what proportion of sattva is there in me? What proportion of rajas is there in me? What proportion of tamas is there in me? So, this differs from body to body. So, when, depending on the particular composition, my mind also wants certain things. I want a particular thing. I don't want a particular thing. Suppose I like music. Some other man may not like music. Suppose I want to study, I want to be peaceful, I want to sit in my room and then do my work. Somebody wants, he is always active, he wants to do more and more, he wants to achieve more. There is more of rajoguna in him. Somebody else, he may be trying to do some criminal activity. He may be trying to do some criminal activity that is a part of rajoguna also. Rajoguna also leads to criminal activity. And also some tamoguna also will be there, some cruelty, etc., etc. So, depending on the composition of the sattva, rajas and tamoguna, the body acts. So, this what happens is, there is what is called superimposition of the qualities of one over the other. So, there is a technical word for that. Technical word is that superimposition. You are superimposing the attributes of this chidabhasa on the body and attributing the qualities of body-mind complex on the chidabhasa. We'll just take a break and come back. Let us come back. So, the samyoga or contact between the kshetra and kshetrajna, between what is totally insentient and what is sentient. What type of samyoga is it? So, that we are trying to understand that. So, the commentators explain that this sanyoga can be explained as that superimposition because of ignorance. Because this chidabhasa, when falling on this antahkarana, that is reflecting in this antahkarana, it gets identified with the body-mind complex. It is identifying with the body-mind complex and the attributes of the body-mind complex, like, I am hungry. I am so and so, I am tall, I am short, I am lean, I am stout, or rather I am fair, I am ugly, etc., etc. And also, I am intelligent, I am not intelligent, I am happy, I am unhappy. So, this whatever happens to that body-mind complex, that chidabhasa, thinks that he is the I. So, that is basically due to ignorance. That is chidabhasa, it has forgotten, it is behaving as though it is identifying with the body-mind complex. And the qualities of this body, the attributes of the chidabhasa are attributed to the body-mind complex. And what are the attributes of the chidabhasa? Chidabhasa is something which is the knower, which is the intelligent being. So, that intelligence of chidabhasa is being attributed to the body-mind complex, which is not intelligent. Because we find, yes, I am intelligent. So, I am attributing that intelligence to my body-mind complex. And the weakness of this body-mind complex is attributed to the chidabhasa. So, because of this sort of itareetara adhyasa, it is called itareetara adhyasa. That is a sort of mutual superimposition. You are attributing the qualities of X on Y and the qualities of Y on X. That is itareetara means one on the other. This qualities of this attributed onto that, qualities of that attributed onto this. Itareetara adhyasa it is called. Adhyasa, there is a particular word called adhyasa, adhi plus asa. Adhi means above, asa means to keep. You are keeping one attribute of one over the other. So, that is what is adhyasa. So, that is the only thing which can be told. Otherwise, there cannot be any contact. There cannot be any contact between the niravayavi. Niravayavi means something which has a pure consciousness, that infinitely pervading consciousness, in which there are no limbs, there is no way of contacting. It is like sunlight. Can you say that sunlight is having contact with the water body? Sunlight, it is in no way, it is having a real contact. It is only an imagined contact. Suppose that sunlight which is falling on a water body, and that water body is shaking, or rather a river is flowing, let us say. River is flowing, and on that river the sunlight is falling. Or maybe on some other place, or maybe moon. Sun, of course, it is an overall reflection we cannot see. If it is moon, we can see the reflection of the moon. Reflection of the moon is the same as sunlight. Instead of sunlight, we say moonlight, where you can see that moon's pratibimba or image also. So that image will also be shaking. So the attributes of the river, that is the shaking, etc., etc., that is again attributed to the pratibimba. And that pratibimba's attributes are the qualities of the pratibimba are attributed to the river. So that is what happens in the case of body-mind complex and the consciousness. So that is the nature of sanyoga. Kshetra kshetrajna sanyogat tadviddhi bharatarshabha. This is a slightly rather subtle point which we have to understand. This is a very subtle point. It also shows that even a plant is having intelligence. Even a plant is having intelligence, a bush is having intelligence. So, kshetra kshetrajna, when you say, whatever yatkinchita sthavara jangamam, by using that word sthavara, it is also including a tree, a plant. So, which means that also is a combination of kshetra and kshetrajna. That means there is intelligence there even in the plant. So, that is again a very important thing which we notice here. So, this word sanyoga is the most important word which we have to understand. In fact, this is a key word in the entire Vedanta. In the entire Vedanta Shastra, it is a very key word. That is adhyasa. Adhyasa means superimposition. Why is this superimposition happening? By ignorance. And how to get rid of this ignorance? By shravana manana nididhyasana. You have to go to your teacher, you have to study Vedanta Shastra, and then you have to meditate on that, and you have to internalize. And once you internalize, then you realize, yes, this is not me. So you discard in the sense you negate that body. So far, I thought that this body-mind complex is my real self. It is not my real self. Once you negate, that avidya goes naturally. So that is what is this shloka. So this word sanyoga is one important thing which we have to understand. Then the next shloka is, next shloka is talking about the vision of oneness. A jnani, what is the result of all this jnanam? Because many people, they keep asking us, what is the use of this jnanam? You read Vedanta and then you sit somewhere in some room and then you think you are a big man. What is the use of your knowledge to the society? What is the use of your knowledge to the common man? The knowledge to the common man is enormous. In fact, we have not realized the effect of this knowledge. Because of this effect of this knowledge, these thought leaders or whoever are the sages, they did not do the mischief of dividing people. They allowed all traditions because of this knowledge. Because of this knowledge, they allowed, okay, somebody was worshipping Vishnu, somebody was worshipping Shiva, somebody was worshipping Ganesha, somebody was worshipping something else. So, because of this knowledge of oneness, people said all are accepted. So, that is the greatest contribution. What is the contribution? The contribution is you are accepting everybody. You are not discriminating. You are not keeping away anybody. You are not suppressing anybody. You are not saying, yes, my religion is the only religion. You are not saying that. You have accepted everybody. That has led to that universal tolerance. So, this jnanam has led to that universal tolerance. And so many traditions are very peacefully harmonized in Indian society. And I have been telling about Shankaracharya, how he was called Shanmata Sthapanacharya. So he went round at his time, when he went round and he discouraged certain non-Vaidic practices. For example, some crude practices like sitting on dead bodies and doing some upasana. And spitting and urinating on the deities and then doing upasana. Etc., etc., what is called Vamachara and Shudrachara. That is not something which is found in the Vedas. So, those things he said, these have to be discouraged. And whatever mainstream traditions were there, some refined traditions. He brought them under the Vedic scheme. He said all shapes, all names and forms are accepted. So that is what Vedanta also says. So when somebody says, what is the use of this Vedanta? You have to say that this Vedanta, because of this Vedanta, we have united the people. Vedanta is something which unites people. Vedanta is something which enables you to tolerate. It gives you that intrinsic sense of accepting all people. It is not as though you are tolerating people because of politics. Not because of politics. You are tolerating because you are not tolerating, you are accepting. Not tolerating again is a bad word. When I say I tolerate you, it means I don't like you, but still I tolerate you. I allow you to be there. So the use of Vedanta, when somebody questions, what is the use of this Vedanta? All abstract and you become a Brahmagyani, etc. The immense contribution is something which we are forgetting. We are not realizing. Because of this, you are accepting everybody. You have no quarrel with anybody. And you are not saying you are the only superior fellow. So that is what is the question. So that thing is being told in this particular shloka, the next shloka. That is, samam sarveshu bhuteshu tishthantam parameshwaram vinashyat svavinashyantam yah pasyati sapasyati. So in Vedanta, very often we get this line, yah pasyati sapasyati. A person who knows this, he has the right vision, he knows it. A person who knows it, he is the one who knows. Means, a person who knows this, his vision is the right, most correct vision. What is that? Samam sarveshu bhuteshu tishthantam parameshwaram. In all the beings, there is only one reality which is present. So this notion of oneness is something which is very, very unique to our Vedanta. This is something which we have to see. So samam. Samam means equally. Samam is equally. Sarveshu bhuteshu tishthantam. Sarveshu bhuteshu means in all the beings. Bhuta. Bhuta does not mean some goblin or something. Some demon or goblin. Bhuta means something, whatever has come into existence is bhuta. Bhudhatu, bhu, the root bhu means to be. Bhuteshu, in all the beings. Tishtantam, tishtantam means staying. Staying means in what sense? That supreme reality, by virtue of its consciousness and existence, that is sat and chit. Sat is that existence. Chit is consciousness. So that sat and chit, belonging to all the beings, they are from the Paramatma only. So whatever Sat and Chit and also Ananda which we are having, Sat, Chit and Ananda, this is something, these three are the attributes of that Paramatma. Only the name and form belong to each being. Only the name and form, they are responsible for, they mean the diversity. But all the beings, the Sat, Chit and Ananda is common to all the beings. And this Sat, Chit and Ananda is the same, the common from the same supreme reality. So samam sarveshu bhuteshu tishtantam. Tishtantam means that is the sthiti karanam, that is the cause for the existence of all these things. Tishtantam parameshwaram. Parameshwara is again, we should not think that Parameshwara is the husband of Parvati, etc. We are not talking about husband of Parvati. We are talking about that Parama Ishwara. Ishwara. Ishwara is what? Ishanam. Ishanam means to lord over. Isha means complete having power, having control. That is what is called Isha. Isha means having complete control. Ishwara means a person who controls. Parama plus Ishwara. Parama means the great, the highest. Parama is that supreme lord. Parameshwara means actually supreme lord, not a person again. For want of words, because we have to use some word in order to describe that reality, we are using this word Parameshwara. It does not refer to a person. So Parameshwaram, that reality, that supreme reality. Then what that supreme reality, vinashyatsu avinashyantam. And when all the bodies are collapsing, vinashyatsu means among all the things which are perishing, which are disappearing, vinasha, vinasha is what? Vinasha, nashi, nashi means disappearing. Vinasha means just disappearing, dying. All the body-mind complexes, all these body-mind complex disappears. Body, of course, it falls and then it disintegrates. And the mind, of course, mind means that is subtle body, it again transmigrates into some other body, etc., etc. These are things which are perishing in nature. So, vinashyatsu avinashyantam, this thing, this supreme reality, or what is called consciousness or intelligence, this is something which is sat and chit, is something, they are something, not vinashyantam, it is something which is not perishing. Avinashi, that in fact in second adhyaya also, vinasham avyayasyasya na kaschit kartum arhasi vaktum arhasi, something like that. We saw in second chapter itself, that is vinasham avyayasya vinasham. This is something which is undeclining, not perishing. So vinasha, it cannot happen to that. So vinashyasu avinashyantam. So that which does not die, which does not disappear. So a person who sees this reality in all the beings. So that means you are seeing oneness in all the beings. And that one reality, that one supreme reality is reflecting in the antahkarana of all the beings. So a person who has this vision, he is the man who is a real, he is the one who is a realized person. And why is he a realized person? Because he is seeing only oneness. He sees that supreme reality in all the beings. That is, in other words, you are seeing Brahman in all the beings. You are seeing Brahman equally manifesting. Samam tishtan. Samam tishtantam. That is equally manifesting. It is manifesting equally in an ant. Shunichaiva Swapakecha Panditas Samadarshinaha. Again, this word sama comes again and again in Veda, in Gita. Sama means equal. Panditas Samadarshinaha means, sama also means Brahman. Shunichaiva Swapakesha, even in a dog, or in a dog eater, or in a learned man, or in an elephant, or a cow, or in an ashwa, or whatever it is, in all these things, this Brahman is something which is equally manifesting. So that is that thing, that vision of oneness is what is repeatedly told in Vedanta. The next shloka also is talking about the same vision of oneness. That is 28, shloka number 28. Samam pasyan hi sarvatra samavasthitam ishwaram na hinastyatmanatmanam tato yati param gatim. So here again he is continuing these two shlokas, and these two shlokas he is talking about this samadrushti. Samadrushti means not seeing all people equally. It can also mean that, but there is a deeper meaning. That is, sama is Brahma. Seeing Brahman in all the beings, not only treating all people equally, all beings, not people, all beings equally or with respect, with love and affection, but seeing Brahman in all things, seeing Brahman in all the sthavara, jangama, in everything. Brahman which is manifesting in all things. So that is the vision which he is going to say in shloka number 28. We will see it tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.